We have with us Professor Yannick Esteve from Avignon University, and he will guide us through a brief history of spoken language understanding. Yannick Esteve is a professor in computer science at the University of Avignon, and he is the head of the Laboratory of Computer Sciences. Professor Yannick has published more than 150 scientific articles in peer-reviewed journals and conferences, all of them focused on spoken language understanding and speech recognition. He has worked as a research engineer at France Télécom and was an associate professor at the University of Le Mans. He's currently a professor at Avignon University, and his research focuses on speech translation, speech analytics, speech recognition, and emotion recognition. I will not make you wait any longer. Professor Yannick, you can start.
Thank
Thank
you.
you.
Thank you, Ruben, for this introduction. Thank you for you and thank you for people and for this invitation. I'm very happy, very proud to be here. So I'm going to make a presentation on the spoken language understanding. It will be brief because I can't talk about that for hours and hours because I work on that for now more than 20 years. So there is a lot of things to explain, but this presentation will stay very general. But I just want to present some general ideas. So two words according to the context of this seminary for me. I think that I was invited by a program because we are collaborating in the SELMA project, a European project. So I saw some other partners present today, so I said them also. And by the past, we also collaborated when I was in Le Mans University in a previous project, NewsBridge project, I think. So it's a collaboration now that's spent on time. Also, I would like to just fastly introduce the laboratory, Laboratoire Informatique d'Avignon, so the Laboratory of Computer Science of Avignon. That is a research unit from the Avignon University. It is this laboratory historically works on speech processing, automatic speech processing, and the laboratory was created on during the 80s, and the researchers Henri Meloni, that was a professor, was a professor on speech processing. But at this time, the technology were based on expert system, so a lot of symbolic artificial intelligence the use, for instance, of programming logic programming or something like that, functional programming and so on. And just very soon after the creation of the laboratory, the statistical approach is mainly hidden model, Markov model, coupled with Gaussian mixture models, became dominant. And it was the time of the period on which the laboratory expanded a lot, and a lot of recruitments were focused on the researcher working with a machine learning approach, especially statistical approaches to process speech. And of course, recently the deep learning, how to say that, it was like a revolution in this topic. And the laboratory now is entirely focused, not entirely because we continue using statistical approaches for some works, but the main technology we are using to make our researches are based on deep neural network. And the last, what I can say, that the laboratory is composed by about 80 people. With 30 permanent research teacher researchers. We are mainly teacher and researchers, and PhD student, postdoc, and so on. and we have three teams. So historically, and the biggest team is dedicated to language, speech and language, mainly speech, network, and optimization. This was for the presentation of my laboratory. And I work for Avignon. I started working for them 3 days, 3 years ago. So spoken language understanding now. So I think the important thing is to start by definition. What is spoken language understanding? And we can consider that it's a branch of natural language understanding. And but the natural language means more about writing document. And if we look at the literature, we can see that in 50 years ago, a cognitician or a psychologist, I don't remember exactly, Professor Chank, wrote in one of his papers that the natural language understanding addressed by computer is so enormous that those who have made attempts to solve the problem have had to severely limit the domain of the particular problem they are trying to solve. And today, 50 years later, I think it is always the same. So what we, when we are talking about speech, spoken language understanding, we consider very limited application. So it is something I'm going to explain later, but we want to project in a very strict, very restricted semantic representation that can be handled by computers, the semantics that are contained in a textual or audio document. For when you're talking about spoken language understanding, we are talking about speech. So we want to extract semantics from speech. And if we take the definition proposed by Professor Renato De Mauri 15 years ago, we can say that SLU, so spoken language understanding, is the interpretation of signs conveyed by speech signal. An important problem in speech in comparison to text is that the linguistic information is mixed with a lot of different information that are present in the audio signal. If we, for instance, about the speaker, we have information about his gender, about his speaker identity. But in addition to that, we have all the information about the acoustic environment. We have the information about the microphones, the channels used to transmit the information. So there are a lot of information, and we have to disentangle. And so it is why speech is not so easy to process. And in addition, in speech, usually, often, speakers don't respect correctly the grammar. So the linguistic message is less structured than the message we can find in text document. So starting from the speech, we want to project, to extract the meaning to a language understood by the speaker. So in this slide, here we have some example of FWEM. So FWEM, it's a semantic representation we use, for instance, for dialogue management, human-machine dialogue management, in order, and the goal is to fill the FWEM with the slot frame by with values, and thanks to these values and the number of slots that are filled, the dialogue manager can ask the question to fill another slot or to make the speaker repeat what you understand at the end to make a suggestion in relation to the dialogue in progress. Here are some example of tasks. So this one, for instance, is a classical named entity recognition task. So it's very easy with a very simple named entity annotation. The idea, so in this sentence, is to detect some word or sequence of words that are that brings semantic information, and we want to extract this information and to categorize this information into different classes. So his people, amount, time, location. And of course, here I'm starting from text, but we want to do the same, starting from speech. This is a simple representation, but we can have more structured semantic representation for exactly the same task. For name entity recognition, for instance, we can have some overlaps and some arborescence to represent the name entity. For instance, this is the location, the place de l'abbé Georges Enoch. So Georges Enoch is a person. Abbé is a title from the church. And place 2 is a place of plaza. It's a location in the city. And so we can have different name entities that are included in the other ones. And so this is for name entities, but as I said before, this can also be more specific to a task. So when we want to work on a human machine dialogue to lead the dialogue, the machine needs some information to extract from the speech and to feed some, its semantic representation. And its semantic representation can be just like this: a list of webs with a lot of information, and according to the goal of the dialogue, if we focus on the dialogue with that is dedicated to a service provided by the machine, we want to capture all the information needed to give an answer to the speaker, to the user. So we can consider, for instance, that third field tasks is like name entity recognition, but with a very more specific and restricted limitation in the domain, right? The domain. But I didn't put these examples in this slide, but we can also talk about call routing, for instance, if someone call for a hotline, and for instance, the first interaction the people can have can be with a machine, and he can explain by speech what he wants, and automatically the machine can route this call to the good service on which human can answer correctly the question. And there are a lot of other kind of applications that can be based on SLU. Of course, you have in mind probably virtual assistants like Siri, OK Google, or something like that. They're based on, they use the spoken language understanding on that. So in terms of research, of course, in the 80s, 70s, there are some research on natural language understanding, but they are more focused in text because the system for automatic speech recognition applied to were not very performant, so it was very hard to get some at least the sequence of words uttered by a speaker. So it was very hard to, in addition, to extract the semantic information. So something that bootstraps the domain of spoken language understanding was in the 90s the building of the 80s corpus by the NIST. So it was in the framework of evaluation campaign, international evaluation campaign, but it was mainly American at this time. And they collected a corpus of human machine interaction, that the machine was played by a result of words. So it was a human playing like a machine. And they collected this corpus that was targeting flight reservation. So, and this thanks to this corpus, a lot, and there are new versions of this corpus later. But thanks to this corpus, a lot of researchers started working on spoken language understanding. So at this time, the goal was to fill SQL, pre-computed SQL request from the speech in order to request to a database. Okay, so there is no really dialogue manager. The goal was starting from a sentence uttered by a speaker. We wanted to rewrite the question under the form of a SQL request. SQL is language to handle databases. So when we started, when we want to start working on spoken language understanding, until recently, we had to apply a pipeline approach. This pipeline approach consists on at least two modules, two different treatments that will be processed sequentially. First, an automatic speech recognition. So we need an automatic speech recognition that will produce a text, and then in this text we'll we tried to apply natural language understanding process. And sometimes in this part, or maybe between this part and this part, between the text and the NLU, we can also enrich the transcription with part of speech, with parsing, chunking, and a lot of different process. So in reality, from speech to the final semantic representation, we can have a lot of treatment, but the two main modules, the two main units were the automatic speech recognition and the natural language understanding. I'm using the past to talk about that, but in reality, actually in the industry, this is the main deployed approach still now. So we have to, if a research team wanted to work on SLU, they had to master an automatic speech recognition system and also a natural language understanding system. So if we start in the 70s and the 80s, we can, as I said before, the technologies used to work on automatic speech recognition were based on human expertise. Okay, so the goal was to be able to ask to a human the recipe he use in order to understand what he can understand, for instance, from this spectrogram. So the picture in this document is a spectrogram. That means that we have two axes. The horizontal axis is the time in seconds, and the vertical axis is about the frequency. So upper you are, higher is the sound. And so there are some people, so I'm not sure that they exist now. Maybe someone can, but at 30 or 40 years ago, some experts were able to, by just looking at the form of this spectrogram, they could say what was the words uttered in the speech recording. So the goal was to ask them how they do that in order to reproduce by using, for instance, logic programming, the same process in the computer. So it was the technology used at this time, and also some computation using DTW, like dynamic programming. But mainly, the idea was to ask the linguists. So there were a lot of collaboration between linguists and computer scientists in order to make speech recognition. And so this was the technology used in the 70s and the 70s was the beginning, and in the 80s they were dominant. But in the 19th, as I said at the beginning of my introduction, the statistical approaches became dominant, and they clearly got really better results than the results, the performance got by the symbolic approach. And this approach was very different because it was based on a different kind of model. One of the The founder of this approach was Frédéric Jelinek from IBM. And he said a very famous sentence saying that at this time, each time I fire a linguist, my system becomes better. So it was very a different school. So they wanted only working on statistics and they don't. And so the main difference that now we are talking about machine learning. So at this time we started using samples, so speech and speech and annotated data in order to train some models. So mainly the goals now was not to analyze a spectrogram, but it was to find a sequence of words that maximizes this formula. So this formula is composed of two components. One is the probability of a sequence of words, which is something we can compute on text documents. So it's given by language models. And at this time, language models were very often based on N1 models with bake-off and discrete techniques. And another part was the formula was the probability to observing a sequence of acoustic features according to the word, the sequence of words we are hypothesizing. And this score was given by acoustic models, and these acoustic models were based on hidden Markov models combined to Gaussian Bestial models. And these were very dominant for 20 years. So the goal in two different kind of models. So these were more about discrete probability. This was more about continuous distribution. And of course, there are also something that is missing here because we also need some linguistic information like how is pronunciated a word. So for each word, we need the sequence of phonemes that build this word. A phoneme is the single unit, the sound unit that can discriminate one word with another one in the language. For instance, I have to find a word in English. In the word car, there is three phonemes: the k, the a, and the r. So the phoneme is very the most the smallest sound units that can that have to be modelized in order to discriminate two words as acoustically. So these acoustic models were used to give a probability to phonemes, and a sequence of phonemes corresponds to one word or several words. And thanks to the language model, we can find the sequence of words that have the highest probability. So it was until 2012, but this the current HMM based model. So today, the most ISR systems deployed in all over the world are still based on the Markovian model, but now they usually are combined with deep neural network instead of GMM, Gaussian models. The difference is now, I come back here, this is a part of a hidden Markov model. So hidden Markov model is a graph. It's like a finite state machine with a lot of states. It's an acyclic model with only one direction. And for each state, we have to compute a probability to observe the acoustic feature at this at one time. And we have to put for each state, according to the state we are and the sound we are analyzing, we have to compute a score that is provided by the GMM models. GMM models are based on means and variances values we have to compute. So now we don't use, this is a simplification of HMM, and we use now a single neural network in order to compute all the scores associated to a state in the HMM model, starting from the signal. Okay, maybe this is the more technical part of my presentation, and don't worry. But what is important is that we just change this component. We use neural network, but it is not end-to-end neural ISR system. This is ISR system, automatic speech recognition system that uses now deep neural network, but the deep neural network are only one component of a system that continue using n-grams models, hidden Markov models in order to modelize phonemes. We continue using a dictionary of words with the pronunciation in terms of sequence of phonemes for each word. So the only difference is that instead of using GMM here to compute this score, for the compute score, we use HMM and GMM, and now we use HMM combined to DNN. So the DNN is just a provider of scores at the frame level. And what happens in 2012 is that Hilton and other researchers from University of Toronto University, Microsoft, Google, IBM, proposed this use of DNN combined it with GMM. HMM, sorry, and they got this word error rate, so the lower is the better, that you can compare in terms of performance to this column. So the difference very, very important, and it was very, really a revolution for this this domain. And yes, so you can refer to this paper if you want more information. And last, currently, so 7 years ago now, Baidu proposed the first very competitive ISR system composed entirely by a neural component. There is no Markovian models. There is no phonemes or something else. There is just as input the signal and output words or characters. Depends. But now we have a speech recognition system that are competitive. They are not always the state of the art. Now it's very hard to say what is the best technology for speech processing, because both are their advantage and their disadvantages currently. My opinion, there are more opportunities to make some improvement in end-to-end approaches than in classical HMM-based models. But currently, in terms of industrial deployment, for instance, I think classical model systems are still very, very competitive. So it depends of the task or the application, the task you are targeting. So when you want to make spoken language understanding, during last years, you have to handle the different kind of technology, first symbolic, after statistical models, HMM, and now you start using only deep neural networks. So to say that it's only one component of spoken language understanding. It was the speech recognition part. I just make a summary here about the different approaches used for the NLU part applied to ISR outputs. But of course, as for speech recognition at the beginning, not at the beginning because maybe they are preliminary work, but 40 years ago, the approaches were more focusing on text, and they were based on formal grammars, on a rule-based approach. There are also some classification tools. For instance, it was very famous at this time in the 90s, the use of classification trees, and some specific classification trees was designed in order to process spoken language understanding. There was also in parallel some works that tried to unify the probabilistic approach with the formal grammar approach by proposing just in probabilistic grammars. So it's like it's for instance context-free grammar, regular language grammar, on which you add some probabilities in the rules you apply when you want to generate sentences by using the grammar. Especially the regular grammars were very widely used under the form of finite state transducer, and they're still used, for instance, in the one of the main was one of the most famous automatic speech recognition. So it's not only NLU, but also for ASR. The most famous open source ASR system is based on the open FST library. So it is the KD system. And this finite state transistor are very, very useful. And they had also been used to process natural language understanding. But the beginning of the century, there was a lot of proposition very efficient by using boosting algorithms like the text boosters, the text booster algorithm that was a boosting algorithm but dedicated to the text processing. And also very famous approach for classification like support vector machines and also statistical machine translation system were used to process the SLU, because of course you can also consider this task like a semantic translation, because as I said at the beginning, our goal is to project into a language recognized by a computer. So for instance, frames or arborescent trees or something like that. We want to project one sentence into a such representation, but it's like translating from one language, a textual language, for instance, to this computer language. So there are also some propositions by using the words. Not they were not very competitive in comparison to other words, but they got good results. So there are some attempts of using statistical machine translation system in order to handle the natural language understanding approach. The main dominant approach was a probabilistic approach based on the conditional random fields. And I know that in QLM, a lot of people are familiar to named entity recognition. And I think that it was the same for named entity recognition for a long time. CRF were, even now, combined with the deep neural network, they are still very, very competitive to process the natural language understanding. And it is the last the last time in this slide. Yes, and also neural networks perform very good, and especially combined with CRF. But they can also get very nice results now by using a pre-trained model like BERT or something like that. I don't have time to describe everything, but it's very dynamic domain. But this slide was to explain that all the slides according speech about speech recognition and about SLU, I presented them in order to show that to work on spoken language understanding for a long time, you needed to have skills and competencies on very different technologies, approaches, models, and so on. Of course, you can become specialized. You can become specialist on only, for instance, semantic classificator trees. But very quickly, you will have some other concurrent with more competitive approach that make your approach obsolete. So you have to update your knowledge and so on. So you need a. And so when you build a team working on this kind of task, SLU task, you need very different competencies and skills. And last, this was my my conclusion. So I can avoid this one. Another important issue. To work on when you work in a pipeline approach on spoken language understanding is that you have to optimize the speech recognition and the natural language understanding coupling. For instance, if you train your models for NLU on texts that are not tokenized in the same way as you tokenized the models, you train your language models and you extract the vocabulary for the speech recognition system, you will reduce the performance. If you don't construct a relevant vocabulary for automatic speech recognition, we will have a lot of out of vocabulary words that are important for the NLU task you want to process, but you won't be able to process correctly some words because they are not included in the ISR vocabulary. So there are a lot of work to do before starting training the models for ISR and for NLU. So it's not easy to optimize all the processes. You need a good coordination between the different teams, so the different people working on the ISR part, on the language models for the ISR, for the NLU coupling, but also, as I said, between ISR and NLU, you can have some NLP process like part of speech tagging, lemma, computation, and so on. So there was a lot of work also in order to optimize the way that the output of the ISR can be used as input of the NLU system. The simplest way was to use only the one best hypothesis, so the only one sentence. It is what I presented at the beginning as example. But in reality, the output of a speech recognition system can be very rich. You can have as output all the search space the system built during the decoding process. And so there are different ways to feed the NLU system by using this search space that has been stored and not emitted. Of course, the spare search can be very large or small according to the heuristic pruning. The heuristic pruning you use during the decoding, there is a lot of variability of the size of the word lattices you can build, for instance, because in general, the search space is of an automatic speech recognition system is represented as a word graph. And so there are also some approaches that consisted on reducing, compressing the word graph by relaxing some constraint. For instance, this lattice can be reduced to this confusion network. So in terms of number of transitions, it can reduce a lot, but in reality, in terms of, combinatory, it can explode because by relaxing some constraints, you accept some sentence here that were not accepted in the initial lattices. So that means that by trying to optimize the coupling between ISR and NLU by waiting before pruning in the graph in the search space before you want to use some semantic information modeled by the NLU system, you want that your NLU system is able to handle lattices or word graph, or word confusion network, or n-best list, or something like that. So you have to change the decoder part of your natural language understanding module. So that means that just if you want to better process better coupling the ISR with NLU, you have to change the NLU part. You cannot use the same algorithms to process a graph than the one you're going to use to process a single sentence. So there were different propositions in this century to deal with this best this better coupling. So these propositions were very relevant in general because they allowed to improve the performance, but one main issue that it was very hard to use this approach with conditional wonder films for computation reasons. So we were there with the spoken language understanding approach, and what it's time is going fast, so I have to speed up. What I wanted to say that I in addition, now I would like to talk about the evaluation of the models, and I talked at the beginning about the ITIS corpus made in the 90s, but there are different other corpus. One main problem is that a lot of people working on SLU now, many people coming from machine learning approach and saying that we are going to work on SLU, makes the experiment on the ITIS corpus here. But there are other ones. The media is in French, SNPs is in English and French, these two ones, M2M is in English. And recently, 2 years ago, one paper was published in the InterSpeech conference, benchmarking the benchmark corpora in order to show that some corpora should be stopped, should not be used now because there is nothing really interesting to learn about this corpora. It is the case, for instance, for ITIS. Just for this corpora, for this slide, I wanted to say that there are different corpus used to benchmark systems, and the harder one is the media corpus. I'm talking about the corpus available for researchers. Of course, I guess that there was a lot of industrial data that are not shared with researchers only in the framework of very specific contracts, but these are benchmark corpora that everyone can use to make some experiments on SLU, and the media one is the most harder because of the quantity of semantics, because of the fact that it's a dialogue, so we have coreference, you have a lot of phenomena that are that make the corpus more difficult to use. So I'm going to focus a little bit to the media corpus to illustrate my discourse, because we worked a lot on this corpus. So it was a corpus that had been created in the beginning of the century. And as for ITIS, it was a corpus that had been collected in order to organize an evaluation campaign. And it is compared of 25 hours of speech with manual semantic annotation. This semantic annotation are related to 76 semantic concepts. Right? So it is a corpus for touristic information. So it's a human-machine dialogue in which the human wants to book a hotel somewhere in France for some days or room. There is all the questions someone can ask to book a hotel. And recently we worked in Le Mans, when I was in Le Mans and now in Avignon, on spoken on the end-to-end approach for spoken language understanding. But that means that we have at the beginning only the speech, the audio signal, and at the end, we will have only the semantic representation without any pipeline, without any other treatment in the cascade approach. So the first motivation is to limit the error propagation between the different modules, and also to make a joint optimization of the single model to the final task. And we work, we proposed in, so 3 years ago, a paper that had been published to process name entity recognition at third task feeding directly from speech by using a single neural language neural model. And as I said, name entity recognition is third task feeding, a very close task. It's the granularity of the semantics that is not the same. One main problem is that to train an end-to-end system, we need a lot of data of speech with manual annotation, and we don't have that. We have only 25 hours, and to train a competitive end-to-end system only for ASR system, a speech recognition system, we need more hundreds of data. So it was the first problem we had to address. To go fast, I'm going to avoid this. It's only details. So what we suggested is to apply transfer learning, but to process, for instance, semantic concept extraction, we train first an ASR system, an end-to-end ASR system for speech recognition with all the data we had. So the 300 60 hours of speech annotated with manual transcription. And after that, we use this model to train an end-to-end system for named entity recognition. So we have about around 300 hours of speech annotated with named entities. And at the end, the model trained here was used to train our end-to-end system on only the 25 hours we have to be the slot filling task system. So the idea is that we keep all the weights from the neural networks, excepting for the last one. The last, the top layer is every time reinitialized because we don't have the same labels as outputs for each neural networks. But it is the same, all the these weights, so the pink ones to the yellow ones are kept from kept at and updated at each point. It's like it's a transfer learning, but in a way that we start with the more general task to the more specific. So it's like a curriculum learning approach applied to control to master the transfer learning. And so we compared the result we had between the best cascade we were able to provide with the best ISR system we had, that was a state-of-the-art system and ISR system and the NLU approach. And we got this result in terms of concept error rate. This one is concept value error rate. That means that we not only look at the concept we have detected, but also to the value we have extracted associated to the concept. In reality, this column is more important than this one. And we saw that we got very better results by using the end-to-end approach. And so for summarize the evolution of the performance on this corpus during time, so we can see that the evaluation campaign based on the media corpus was made only on manual transcription, like the ATIS one. They don't really work on speech at the beginning. So the spoken language, it was SLU, but applied to a correct transcription. And the concept error rate was more than 90%. And we can see that the first system we had with ISR and CRF was obtained 28% of concept error rate. And of course, this decrease. And now, with the end-to-end approach, so the last line, with the end-to-end approach, people are able to get less than what we get from manual transcription 15 years ago. So this is a very good progress. And this one, last year, by using BERT-like model, just fine-tuning the BERT-like model, applied on text, not on the on speech, of course, we got people can got this very low result. So for speech, we think that now end-to-end approach is the new state of the art, but it's not sure that it will continue because we want to make some experiments in very close future, not only us but other teams all over the world by using pre-trained model like BERT applied to output of ISR outputs. But whatever, we consider that the motivation based on the investigation of end-to-end approach is well justified because thanks to the performances we had. And something very important, I think, and it's very important for researchers, but also for industrials, is that there was only one module to maintain, not a lot of different modules with different technologies. So of course, it's maybe a little bit harder to make some adaptations, so to add a word or something like that. But so there are some research work in progress currently to do that. But it is very easier to maintain only one module instead of a different kind of module. And we showed also in the one paper you published 1 or 2 years ago that I didn't talk about that, but end-to-end approach don't work with word. They work, the ISR system based on end-to-end approach work with sub-word units, sub-lexical units. by doing that, for instance, only characters instead of writing words, the character words they emit word by using character by emitting character by character. So, for instance, at the output of end-to-end neural approach for ISR, you can have only the alphabet and by the sequence of letters compose the sequence of words. So you don't have the limitation of the vocabulary is not important in comparison to the one to the vocabulary used in the classical ISR system. And so the perfect is now about using, of course, self-supervised pre-trained speech representation and language representation. So, for instance, by combining Wave2Vec and BERT, and I know that this month one paper has been published on archive on that. In Avignon, for instance, we are working on language portability. That means that how we can, we have, for instance, a system to deal with French. How we can make it in Portuguese, for instance, by collecting a very, very small data in Portuguese. We have also, I know that we have also some initial partners that are interested by working in a noisy environment or with very, very small hardware. So we have some issues about model compression. And a long time, I think we're going to work on more open domain. Something important, I think, it's also the integration of different kind of knowledge. Multimodality also is very important. And also models that are able to process many languages at one time. I finished.
Thank you very much, Professor Yannick. What a great journey through spoken language understanding. Now we have time for some questions. So if anyone wants to ask a question, you can click the raise hand button and I will then ask you to unmute and you can ask your question. If you have any issues, you can also ask questions through the chat. So feel free to use these two methods. So in the meanwhile, I have a small question. As you told us, there are essentially two main approaches, right? One more classical pipeline with those two parts and the end-to-end. Do they make the same kind of mistakes? So in terms of error analysis, are there any characteristical differences between what they get wrong, what each one gets wrong?
For now, the error analysis we made show that yes, they provide the same kind of errors. We were not sure about that. It was a surprise for me. But yes, it's so the end-to-end approach makes less errors in all the categories. But there is no something that is more that is specifically better processed in comparison to the classical approach. So yes, there is no difference.
Right, that's interesting. I was expecting that one would be more.
Yes, one difference, it's about the out of vocabulary. There are less errors in terms of, because it is very important for us because as I said at the beginning, it's very important when you make in a pipeline approach, when you build the system to take care of the coupling between the ISR output and the NLU output. So you have to share the same vocabulary, the same normalization, and so on. But some words are missing in the ISR system, you have to retrain your language models. You sometimes, depending of the technology you are using for the ISR, you have to recompile all the search space. So it can take a long time just to add one word in the speech recognition system. It is, and of course, since you don't have seen all the sequence, of, the possible sequence of words that that a user can use when he speaks to a dialogue manager, to a machine, for instance, that means that there is a lot of words that you cannot transcribe. And so this is really a problem. While the end-to-end approach continue making some errors, of course, because it's not magical. If it has never seen a one word, he has more difficulties to construct this word, but he can. So sometimes there is a I think it was the third, I have to check that, but 30% of out of vocabulary words were correctly recognized by the end-to-end by our end-to-end approach. So it's this different that is important maybe because of the lexical unit used by the end-to-end approach.
Thank you. And that's interesting. So are there any other questions? So if there are no further questions, once again, we have a question. Oh no, it's not a question. It's a clap. So once again, thank you, Professor Yannick. Very, very interesting journey. And thank you all for being here. This is it for today. We will be back in 2 weeks at the same time. Goodbye, and I hope to see you here again. Thank you all, and thank you, Professor. Very interesting.
Thank you again for this invitation.
Of course. Our pleasure. Thank you, and goodbye, everyone.